Well, just a brief introduction, what does it mean liver transplantation in Romania as it appears in the program. Liver transplantation in Romania now means two programs in Romania proper and one more program in Republic of Moldova, which is more or less a program in the Romanian space, generally speaking. So therefore, I think after 17 years since the first liver transplantation in Fundeni, after 14 years since the first successful liver transplantation in Fundeni, this is for the first time when three additional presentations have to be noticed. One, it's regarding the living related program in Fundeni, which is sort of offspring of the general program of transplantation in this institute. And second, the new programs in the Sfânta Maria Hospital and in Chișinău. Except the things that I'm going to show you regarding the results in Fundeni, again, probably this is the greatest achievement of the team that started long time ago already liver transplantation in this area. Therefore, I will speak about liver transplantation in Fundeni Clinical Institute, current status and future perspectives. Now we see all over the world about 2,000 procedures are performed annually. So that shows the increase in the indication of these procedures, shows the increase of the number of centers, of the number of procedures performed by every center. Honestly, in the 90s or early 2000s, centers performing 30 or 40 livers were considered strong enough to continue to do this procedure. Now, sure, most of the centers are above 50 per year and some centers above 100 per year. There's no more an exception. It might become the rule more or less. That's because the number of candidates on the waiting list are is definitely increasing also. It has been said that the liver transplantation is the victim of its own success. The fact is that almost in no center in the world, and particularly in Europe, the number of procedures does not cover the whole waiting list, does not cover the total number of the patients on the waiting list. And on this waiting list, there is still mortality. And actually, and this will be the main idea of the presentation, increasing the numbers has the main target, decreasing the mortality on the waiting list. As you will see, the post-operative results for us remain almost the same, because the more transplants we perform, the more we accepted difficult candidates, sometimes in a critical condition. It was not exactly the purpose of this program to reduce the immediate post-operative mortality, which I don't think it's possible. Only if you decline the possibility of transplantation to such critical patients, which is not quite ethical. But the most important achievement is reflected on the waiting list. It's just there where the waiting time is getting shorter and shorter, and the mortality on the list it's getting it's diminishing more and more. This is a short history of liver transplantation in Romania, with some moments that I already mentioned. In this country and in this area was a continuous fight to implement a law, to implement the concept of brain death, to implement organ donation, to educate people, to educate medical staff, involved in a whole process of identifying donors, of maintaining donors, of coordinating the donor harvesting, and this is reflected in these moments that I mentioned here. In Romania, again and again, I will say that the most important moment for us was the founding of the National Transplant Agency, and since then, as you will see, it was a clear difference. And here you can see the procedures that we perform and the difference that I'm speaking about. So until 2006, you can see the number of procedures was small. 2006, I would say, was a crucial year for us. The transplant agency started to work in 2005. Already at the end of 2006, we reached 20 transplants, and since then was an increase, reflecting except 2009, where the agency had the big problems in the summer. I won't go into details, but they did not belong to the agency. Still, immediately the number of donors dropped. But then we restarted to grow, and this big increase in between 2012 and 2013, where was an accumulation of factors that determined almost a doubling of the number of donors and of transplantation. And these factors were introduction of the transplant coordinators and kidney donation persons in the hospitals, and the media campaign on a TV channel that was very successful. This is the number of procedures in total. This year, 82 procedures were performed in Funden hospitals, and another 14 that will be presented after this presentation in Sfânta Maria Hospital in Romania. The indication is, in general, hepatitis and cirrhosis remain the main indication, followed by HCC. HCC becomes more and more an important indication for liver transplantation. I will come back on this idea later. And you see, if we speak only about the adults, HCC is even more important. It's on the first place among the indication in adult patients, followed by cirrhosis determined by viral hepatitis. In pediatric cases, we have 62 cases. The fact that Wilson disease is almost equal with biliary atresia shows that we have grown up children. So an indication for liver transplantation is in children that are 14, 15, 16 years old, still considered children. The classical indication of biliary atresia in very small kids. Usually it's more common in the big programs in Western Europe. In our program, first of all, we try not to transplant the children below 1 year of age and below 10 kilos of weight. And this explains why these two diagnoses are almost equal. Because as I mentioned, usually biliary atresia is much more an indication than Wilson disease in children. These are the types of liver transplantation that we perform. Whole liver was by far the most often performed procedure, and then living related. Living related is a procedure that we try to perform more and more, and we try to increase the number of cases. As I mentioned, the mortality remains stable. There's no much difference along the years. My expectation is that will not change in the near future. But on the waiting list, all over the world there is a mortality. The time on the waiting list depends on the number of donors and the number of procedures. And when you have a small number of donors, when you desperately need a liver, either for an acute liver failure or for a retransplantation, you don't have it if you have few donors. As you can see in the US, 10,000 new patients are added each year on the waiting list. Still, 15,000 are still there at the end of a given year. And in Romania, in 2013, 150 new patients were added, and a total of 450 were still waiting on the waiting list. Here is the dynamic on the waiting list. Now we have almost 550, so it's 544 patients in 2004. And although we increased the number of procedures, you can see that we are pretty far from covering all the list. And this is normal because the number of procedures we do related to the population of Romania could be considered still small. Here is the time. As you can see in the beginning, we cannot even speak about a certain waiting time is ridiculous, because like 100 months for blood type 0, and then in the period 2009-2012 that waiting time decreased, but was still quite significantly quite high, more than 1 year for every blood type. And only recently 2013-2014 we can speak on a decent waiting time. So there is no blood group with waiting time more than 1 year. B, which is the rarest, has a little bit less than 1 year, and all the others, in all the others, the waiting time significantly decreased. And the overall mortality on the waiting list here, the same impressive difference between 30% 1 year mortality before 2012, and since 2012, 11.8, which is the current mortality on the waiting list. It's a, I would say, dramatic decrease, and this was the most important objective that we achieved. So therefore, again, the goals, reduction, the dropout on the waiting list through morbidity and mortality, and shortening the time on the waiting list, and providing liver grafts for acute liver failures and emergency transplantations. For this, the most important strategy was to try to increase continuously, with the help of the National Agency of Transplantation, the number of deceased donors. To accept the marginal grafts, which is a risky business, because always when you accept the marginal grafts, you take the risk of primary non-function, but all over the world, those marginal grafts, particularly because of age donors, it's almost the rule. Now the population of the world, and especially in Europe, is aging, and some of those persons become donors, and the rule is to accept most of them if there is no other contraindication. Other sources of liver grafts, early poison donors, we use methanol intoxication, and livers with trauma, livers with tumors, that we remove on the back table. And again, like technical variant graft, is pushing more and more to increase the number of living donation. We use in some cases split liver transplantation, dual grafts, and donor liver transplantation. In the world, so the rates of donation are variable. As we know, in Europe, the champions are in Europe, and there are two champions. One is an old one, is Spain. Spain was for maybe the last 20 years the champion, European champion, world champion in organ donation, because of an orchestrated and very good policy towards organ donation in hospitals and good organization. And now Croatia is following with a slightly different model, but as successful as the Spanish model. Otherwise, so we see the 20 per million in the US is probably the average, even lower in Europe, and less than 8, and was 7 point something last year as the donation rate per million of inhabitants, which was the most successful, biggest in Romania. But still, you can see compared with the international figures, it's still low. Among those donors, about 75 to 80 are liver donors. Here is the number of donors in Romania. The graphic is almost the same as the number of transplants. As you can see, before 2006, small number of donors, less than 20, and then this increased with the accident in 2009, and again increased, and this doubling of the number of donors in 2013. Well, all these things, low education of professionals, mass education, and hospital efficiency, introducing the transplant coordinators and key donation persons, were the factors that determine the current situation in organ donation in Romania. What do we do? So I mentioned before that we are obliged to use more and more those donors. We call them extended criteria donors, or marginal if you want, because they are either age or fat, or have a long ICU stay, or were not properly kept in the ICU, or have steatosis, which is an important factor for dysfunction or non-function of the transplanted liver, or hypernatremia, or high enzymes before the harvesting. The only factor that is not actually, we never had a liver transplanted with more than 14 hours cold ischemia time. I think it's not even possible. usually we try to make the cold ischemia time less than 6 hours, which is pretty short, but definitely we are not going to use a liver after 14 hours. In all the other categories, except fat donors, you can see that we had donors that we accepted. Same with viral infections, we accepted infected with B for B patients on the list. We accepted even one case with C hepatitis for patients with hepatitis on the list. Sepsis in the donor is still accepted. You have to perform prophylaxis with antibiotics in the recipient, but you can accept the donors. Malignancy, or if it's extrahepatic, we accepted one case with a brain tumor. And in one case, the non-heartbeating donor is a category. I will not extend the discussion, but in the United Kingdom and maybe and even in Belgium, in Spain, becomes more and more popular. This is the donor is cardiac arrest, where harvesting the liver involves some very special conditions. There are countries that refuse this kind of donation. In Germany, it's not even accepted by law. But as I mentioned, there are countries where a fair number of donors each year are coming from this category of non-heartbeating donors. Strategies. What strategies can we apply? There are two points, two strategic points, I would say. First of all is to choose a recipient with a low MELD score, because a very sick recipient with high MELD, it's not going to make it with a marginal liver. It's not going to survive with a marginal liver. Therefore, because sometimes in hepatocellular carcinoma, these are well-compensated cirrhotic patients with low MELD, and some of them are even marginal or beyond Milan criteria, we consider that it's ethical to allocate marginal livers to this category of patients. So, which beyond or with borderline Milan criteria. And the second point of the strategy was to have cold ischemia time as short as possible, ideally below 6 hours. If those points are fulfilled, and you can see the number of marginal donors is increasing, it's 35% in our experience, but if you respect the indications, again, cancer is the main indication. These are other sources of grafts, metal points, or this is liver graft trauma, benign tumors, Takayasu syndrome. This is a hematoma in a transplanted liver. See, day 19, hematoma is gone, so it's possible to use. This is a liver with lacerations, important laceration. Then hemostasis was performed on the back table, but also in situ after the implantation. And here is the liver with a tumor, was an adenoma, was removed on the back table, and this is the cut surface of the liver in the operation. And this is a rare case of Takayasu disease with almost no abdominal aorta. Therefore, we had to find ways, first of all, to cannulate and to perfuse the liver during the harvesting, and then to implant the liver. This is the abdominal aorta, almost stopped at the level of the diaphragm. So we had to find ways to perfuse. As I mentioned, the liver was vascularized through an artery included in the falciform ligament coming from the thoracic aorta, and this was used for cannulation during the harvesting. And also the gastroduodenal was patent and had some flow from the superior mesenteric artery. But again, if you respect the two things, matching with a recipient with low MELD and shortening the cold ischemia time as much as possible, you can have almost similar results with the normal donors. Living related, also it's debated as an indication all across the world, has some advantages because it can be performed on an elective basis with optimal timing and no waiting time for the recipient. The graft is in excellent condition. We are obliged even to biopsy the liver of those donors, and we accept them only if the liver is totally normal, completely normal. The ischemic time is short because you perform the operation in the same hospital in the next room. And you can accept this for extended indications like HSC beyond Milan criteria. Main disadvantage is mortality in donor. I have a long discussion with Professor Ford yesterday. This mortality is not zero at international level. And centers performing this procedure should expect that one day they will have one death, at least for the donor, which, well, it's the big problem of the procedure. As you know, there were programs in the world that were stopped after deaths in the donor, including my program, in the program where I've learned this procedure in Mount Sinai, New York. Still, if the risks are explained to the donors and accepted, and if the donor is still persistent in the desire to donate for his relative, the procedure is accepted in many, many centers, and particularly in Asia, because in Asia they don't even have another option since the number of cadaveric donors is small. Other disadvantages, well, the vascular and biliary complication rate is bigger because instead of having a big channel, you have sometimes two, and some of them are small, same with the vessels. And this, there is also the risk of small for size syndrome. A fragment of the liver, no matter how big it is not the same as with a whole liver. And sometimes the proportion between the weight of the transplanted fragment and the weight of the recipient is not the same that we calculated before. And under those circumstances, this small for size syndrome can appear. The liver behaves like an insufficient liver because the liver volume is not enough for the weight of the recipient. Here is the number of procedures of living related among the whole experience of 601 patients at the beginning of October. There were 111 living. The number along the years was not big, pretty small in the beginning, and now it's increasing. This year we've performed, I think there is one more, probably 17. We prepare to perform another one, so we'll end up almost with the same rate as last year, 15 livers, but sure, there is room for more. It depends also on the cadaveric donors, because sometimes when there are couples who is a living prepared to donate for his relative and the cadaveric donor appeared, we cancel the living donation and we prefer to use the cadaveric. That happened when the number of cadaveric donors was bigger than that was in the middle of 2013. We perform living in pediatric, where actually it started in 1989 with Christoph Brush in Chicago, and is the most common indication, but also in adults, as I mentioned before, and we use for children most often left lateral section, and for adults most often the right hemiliver. About the surgical technique, these are parts of the operation, and you can see after dissecting the pedicle, we can establish the demarcation line by clamping the artery and portal vein, and then we see the line that we are going to transect. Of course, here the cutting of the vessels and even of the bile duct is the last step of the operation. First of all, for the vessels, because you have to keep the graft vascularized, and for the bile duct, because only at the very last part of the operation we can see clearly what is the bile duct or the ducts belonging to the right side and what goes to the left hemiliver. Parenchymal transection, as you can see, identifying the segmental veins of 5 and 8, which most of the time will be reconstructed on the back table. And then the two basic techniques in liver transplantation, living transplantation. Initially we started harvesting the middle vein and implanting the middle vein in the recipient, which gives much better chance to the recipient, but put the donors in jeopardy, and the risk for the donors are much bigger if you harvest the middle hepatic vein. And the way we do today, we don't harvest the middle hepatic vein, but just reconstruct the veins for segment 5 and 8 and put this Y graft to the stump of the middle and left hepatic vein of the recipient. This, well, on the back table it's more work to perform, but like this you keep the donor in much safer condition. Still, on the other hand, reconstructing those veins is mandatory in order to have good results. And changing to this technique after the experience in Korea learned by some of the members of the team, well, actually change dramatically the results. Again, intraoperative aspects of venous reconstruction at the level of segments 5 and 8. And this is a postoperative control that shows patent vascular anastomosis, including the venous graft. And here is a survival after in the comparison between whole liver transplantation and living donor transplantation. Still, the survival is better in the whole liver, which shows that things had to be improved in living donations regarding, first of all, the evaluation of the volume of the liver, and second, and I will come back on this idea, sometimes maybe using more and more the dual graft, which I think it's a good option. It seems a bit futuristic, but still, I believe it's a good option, because using, we'll see, the dual graft here is like using the whole liver. Now the split liver. Split liver is dividing a liver in two and using for two recipients. It started in Italy, used this procedure extensively to transplant all the pediatric patients, and they harvested the split the liver in two parts, not equal, unequal. So they used the segment 2 and 3 for a child, and the rest of the liver for an adult. Splitting for two adults is a much more complex procedure and much more risky. You should have small adults, small recipients, usually not much than 50-55 kilos, in order to survive with two halves of the liver. This is the technique. You can split the liver either on the back table or in situ. On the back table, the procedure is lengthy because you cannot see the structures as inside. While inside, it's more complicated because you continue to lose blood and you keep the operating room going for more time, which sometimes is not possible. It depends on the cooperation with the donor hospital. Again, parts of the operation of splitting on the back table and splitting inside too. We perform a total of 9 procedures, which are split procedures for 18 recipients, and in one case was a combination of split and domino. Most of them adult and child. Two of them were adult and adult. So 4 adults live today with 4 halves of the liver that we transplanted. Here is a couple. This is an adult, 20 years old male with cryptogenetic cirrhosis. He received an extended right lobe. And this is the child, 9 years old female, that received the left lateral section. That was that type of splitting unequal between the right and the 2 and 3 segments. Here is another couple, the first couple of splitting for 2 adults. He was 18 years old, and you can see it's a real adult. Quite big, but still the right lobe of the liver was enough for him. And Ms. Dobranis is a counselor of the Minister of Education, so is now enjoying life with the left lobe that was close to 500 milliliters weight. The dual, as I mentioned, when the right lobe is not enough, then if the patient has 2 donors instead of 1 for large families, using 2 grafts, I think it's a good option. It's a very good option. It's a very good option. Because like this, in this first and only case so far that we performed, the recipient was a big girl, also quite young, but big, 15 years old. So she had 2 donors. 1 donor was her mother, and 1 donor was her sister. And together, those halves accomplished a total weight that was very well fitted for and in accordance with the weight of the recipient. So, like this, there was no problem of small for size. Operation was more complicated, but like this, we transplanted the whole liver practically. And as I mentioned, in total, the results with the whole liver are better than with the fragment, as we, compared to the living donor with only 1 graft. When you use 2 grafts, so probably you can have the same results as in a whole donor donation. Here are some aspects intraoperatively. So this is the hepatocaval anastomosis for the left lateral. The right lobe is already in place. And in the left lateral was anastomosis to the stump of the middle and left hepatic vein. Here we couldn't do the same as we do, so the reconstructed 5 and 8 was implanted in the vena cava because the stump was left for the anastomosis, which is the left lab vein. And this is the mother and sister, the donor sister, and this is the recipient, and the three of them are in good condition so far, quite a long time, about 2 years, more than 2 years after the operation. And this is the post-operative aspect. At the CT, you can see it's almost like a normal liver. You barely can differentiate it, and you can barely realize that it was actually a living donor. And domino transplantation, unfortunately, we didn't have any other case. This is an old case. The recipient has already 13 years of survival. It was a combination, so a normal liver was split for an adult and a child. The child had the glycogenosis, the adult has this familial hypercholesterolemia, and the liver of the adult was used for this patient with cancer, and she is alive and well at 13 years after the operation. Unfortunately, the child died with a pneumonia in the postoperative period. In conclusion, I think that using all those strategies to extend the donor pool, relieve the pressure on the waiting list, with a good recipient survival rate was similar, but the pressure on the waiting list was much less. The limits of the extended criteria were constantly pushed over time, but there is still no consensus on these limits. Sometimes they are empirical and are based on clinical practice. Living related is nowadays a standard procedure and established method to increase the donor pool size. Split, dual, and domino, also rare procedures, are good methods to expand the donor pool. And the proper donor-recipient matching is the key for the optimal use of marginal and surgical variant grafts. And this is an image we celebrate every year, the day of transplantation in Romania, and on this occasion, all those transplanted people, just part of them, come and celebrate the success of liver transplantation as an operation. Thank you very much.